As we continue our study of the fundamentals of our faith and what we believe as Baptists, and wasn't it a great experience to be able to enjoy and share in the experience of joy with Erica tonight as she was being baptized? And why was there such a joy in her life? It's because of what we're going to talk about tonight. It's the doctrine of salvation. And it's more to her than just a doctrine, it's a reality. And I was thinking as I was seated on the front row and she was being baptized, Lord, just give me a little bit of that. You know, sometimes after we've been saved for a long time, we forget about, you know, what should be a living reality in our hearts all the time. You know, if all we had to thank God for was the gift of salvation, we would have enough to thank Him and to praise Him throughout the rest of eternity. Thank God I'm saved. I remember the old African-American evangelist and pastor E.V. Hill. Y'all remember E.V. Hill? Any of you ever hear him preach? And one of the most powerful sermons I've ever heard anyone preach in my lifetime was preached by Dr. E.V. Hill, and the title was Thank God I'm Not Going to Hell. And he really highlighted the beauty and the grace and the wonder of salvation. And tonight I want to talk about the doctrine of salvation. What does that really mean? The theologians refer to it as the doctrine of soteriology. But what is it that we believe as Baptists about soteriology? You know, you can take the idea, this whole issue of salvation, and really you can put it in two categories, right or wrong, biblical or unbiblical. That's about all you can do with this whole idea of salvation. And when it comes to all of the teachings and the belief systems of salvation, all of them are placed in one of two categories. And that is either salvation by works or salvation by the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ. I mean, there's nothing else you can say. And anything that is added to grace and faith is works. And any kind of work salvation, it's not a biblical salvation. And the sad thing is, it will not get you to heaven when you die. The only salvation that works, a biblical salvation, is a belief in the doctrine that salvation comes by the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ alone, with absolutely nothing else added to it. So that's what I want us to talk to us about tonight. And I want to kind of center our thoughts around Luke's gospel, chapter number 1, in the prophecy of Zacharias when he was prophesying about John the Baptist. And we see in what John's mission was, we see in here a lot about salvation and what Jesus would do and why he came. In Luke chapter 1, verse number 76, and you, child, John the Baptist, you shall be called the prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord for the purpose of preparing his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins through the tender mercy of our God, with which the day spring from on high, and that's just a messianic title given to the Lord Jesus in the Old Testament, with which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light to those who sit in darkness, the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the way of peace. And that really is the salvation that the Lord Jesus came to bring unto you and unto me. Now let me give you a little rather lengthy quote from the Baptist Faith and Message, and it simply states that salvation involves the redemption of the whole man. And it's offered freely to all who accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, who by His own blood obtained eternal redemption for the believer. In its broadest sense, salvation includes regeneration, sanctification, and glorification. Then there's a brief synopsis of these three that I'll talk about later. Regeneration, the Baptist Faith and Message says, or the new birth, it's a work of God's grace whereby believers become new creatures in Christ Jesus. It is a change of heart that is wrought by the Holy Spirit through conviction of sin, to which the sinner responds in repentance toward God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, repentance and faith, as the Baptist Faith and Message states, are inseparable experiences of grace. In other words, two sides of the same coin. Can't have one without having the other. Repentance is a genuine turning from sin toward God. Faith is the acceptance of Jesus Christ and a commitment of the entire personality to Him as Lord and Savior. Now that's extremely important, as Lord and Savior. He can't be Savior apart from being Lord, because the Lord is who He is. He's called Jesus Christ the Lord. I like that passage over in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, that if we will confess with our mouths that Jesus is what? Lord. And believe in our hearts that God has raised Him from the dead, we shall be saved. Because with the heart, man believes unto righteousness, and with confession, salvation becomes a part of our experience, a confession of our faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Now, let me just kind of get off track just a second. That Romans 10, verses 9 and 10, what it tells us is that to believe in Jesus as Lord is to believe everything the Bible says about Jesus. It's to believe in His virgin birth. It's to believe in His vicarious substitutionary death. It's to believe in His death, burial, resurrection. It's to believe in His ascension. It's to believe in His coming again. Oftentimes people have said, well, you don't have to believe in the virgin birth to be saved. Oh, yes, you do. You do, because you're not believing in Jesus as Lord as presented in the New Testament apart from believing that. So to believe in Jesus as Lord is to believe everything the New Testament says about Him. Justification, the booklet goes on to say, is God's gracious and full acquittal upon principles of His righteousness of all sinners who will repent and believe in Christ. Justification brings the believer into a relationship of peace and favor with God. Remember, justification is a declarative, judicial act of God, where God looks at the believing sinner and declares him or declares her not guilty. I've heard theologians say before that when a person gets saved, that God looks at them and God looks at them as if they have never sinned. I don't believe that. I believe that God looks at them through the work of Christ that died for their sins. And God looks at that person that's trusted Jesus as Lord and Savior, and with a declaration, an act of His will, He declares them to be not guilty. Boy, aren't those two great words. I tell you, they may sound great in a courtroom today, but they sound greater in the courtroom of God. To look at us through the work of Christ and declare us not guilty for being sinners. Sanctification is the experience that begins in regeneration, by which the believer is set apart to God's purposes and then is enabled to progress toward moral and spiritual perfection through the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Now notice I put the word progress in there, because that idea of sanctification is something that we will never achieve and reach in this lifetime. You know, we're moving toward it, but it will finally be realized in what we'll talk about in a moment, and that is our glorification. Growth in grace should continue throughout the regenerate person's life. There should never be a moment in time before we die that we stop growing in the grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Peter said, but grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord, Jesus Christ. And then glorification is the culmination of our salvation. It's the final, blessed, and abiding state of the redeemed. And I hope that there is one thing that we have learned in our study up to this point, and that is how absolutely essential it is for us as believers to study doctrine. Absolutely essential. A Christian not studying doctrine is like a brain surgeon not going to medical school. I tell you, if we get mixed up in our doctrine, we are mixed up in everything in the Christian life. And a church that is not built on a solid doctrinal foundation, you know, that just everything comes and goes, then that church will be driven about by every wind and wave of doctrine that comes along. So we've got to solidify ourselves in our biblical doctrine. and we need to know what we believe as Baptists. So the first thing I want to talk about then is the word salvation. If we're going to talk about the doctrine of salvation, we need to understand the meaning of the word salvation. The earliest meaning of that Greek word salvation, which is the word soteria, is a word that was translated, listen, health and wholeness. So initially, salvation just literally meant health and wholeness. So to be saved was to be restored to health. Now, why was that important, and why did the early believers look at it like that? Because our alienation from God, our estrangement from Him, our bondage to sin, it's all made us sick, made us desperately ill. And to be freed from that, to become well and have health and wholeness, we have to be saved. We have to experience this doctrine that we're talking about called salvation. Let me just go on to say that this bondage to sin and this alienation from God, it didn't simply make us sick, it made us dead. And that's why we needed to be saved, because we were spiritually dead. So the first thought I want you to keep in your mind is to be saved is to receive health, because it delivers us from the power of sin that brings sickness and death. Now, there are times that the word soteria that is used in different senses. For example, in Matthew chapter 8, verse number 25. I want to jot down that verse, Matthew 8, 25. It's a word that is used to speak of rescuing from danger or destruction. Matthew chapter 8, verse number 25. Remember, the disciples are out on the sea. They're in a storm. And it said, then His disciples came to Him and awoke Him, saying, Lord, here's the word, soteria. Lord, save us. We are perishing. So the idea there is to save from destruction or to save from danger. Over in the book of Acts, chapter 27 and verse number 20, we find the same usage of the word here, Acts 27, verse 20. Now, remember, this is Paul's shipwreck, and it says, when neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and no small tempest beat upon us, all of our hope that we should be, the word soteria, that we should be saved, was finally given up. So there are times that the word was used to describe rescuing from danger or destruction. But there were also times when the word was used to speak of healing from disease. Matthew chapter 9, verse number 22. But Jesus turned around, and when He saw her, that's the woman with the issue of blood, He said, be of good cheer, daughter, your faith has made you well. And the word well there is the word soteria, the word that means saved. So it's used in those ways, but the greatest use is in regard to our spiritual salvation that comes through Christ. And that word appears many, many times in the New Testament. For example, in Matthew chapter 19, verse number 25, we see the word used in that vein. In that verse, after He told the story about the rich young ruler, verse 25 says, when His disciples heard it, they were greatly astonished, saying, who then can be saved? The word soteria. So the greatest usage of the word is speaking of Christ's salvation that is given freely unto us. Remember John chapter 3, verse 17, back up to verse 16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be what? Might be saved. It's the word soteria. So that word is used more often in speaking of spiritual salvation that comes through Christ. Now, understand, when we're talking about the doctrine of salvation, and we're talking about this salvation coming through the Lord Jesus Christ, we must understand with a deep conviction that it's offered to believers, number one, by God's initiative. God's the one that takes the initiative to give us the offer. And every time that He places that offer out there, it is always a demonstration of His love for sinners. John 3:16 again points that out. And you know, when He gives salvation, we talk about that as everlasting life or eternal life. What we need to know is that that everlasting life or eternal life does not begin after death, but that life actually begins the moment of our conversion, the moment we experience salvation, because it is a quality of life that begins at the moment of conversion that simply extends throughout all eternity. Another thing that we better nail down is that this offer that God makes is based only on the death of Christ. The death of Christ that satisfied the holy nature and the holy demands of the righteous law of God, which says that the soul that sins, it shall surely die, that the wages of sin is death. So that offer then is based on the death of Christ that satisfied the nature and the righteous law of a holy God. And therefore the key is, Jesus is the only one through whom that offer comes. Can I get a witness? He's the only one through whom that offer comes. Hebrews chapter 9, verse number 12 says, "Not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood he entered into the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption." John 14, 6, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me." See, God's offer of salvation is not extended on any other terms. And that is why we as followers of Christ, we ought to get riled up when we hear people teaching and preaching the offer of God's gift of salvation through any means other than the shed blood of Jesus. Why? That's trampling underfoot the blood of the Son of God. And so that's why we take the doctrine of salvation very seriously. The word salvation speaks of wholeness, speaks of wellness, speaks of those that were desperately ill, but now the disease has been taken away and they are made whole. Second thing I want to look at is the way of salvation. Now, friend, the way of salvation, and get this, if I can explain it, the way of salvation is predicated on the fact of our need of salvation. And our need of salvation is predicated on the fact of our understanding of what our condition is. What is our condition apart from Christ? Sinful. We are sinners. And therefore, it is our sin problem that creates the problem. Because our God is perfect, holy, righteous, without sin. As a matter of fact, the Bible says of Jesus that he knew no sin. The Bible says of those that looked at Jesus in his day as he walked throughout life around this earth, we can see no guile in him, no hypocrisy in him. The problem is the Bible says that God is of purer eyes than to behold evil. And therefore, being sinful, we cannot exist in the presence of God. His Shekinah glory would light us up and burn us to a spark. So somehow we've got to get rid of the sin issue. And see, that's where the Lord Jesus Christ comes in. And that is why today it seems to be difficult to reach a culture that debates whether or not there even is such a thing as sin. Friend, let us not debate it. I'll guarantee you there is such a thing as sin. It's prevalent, isn't it? All around. So to deny the reality of sin is, number one, to deceive oneself. John says in 1 John chapter 1, verse 8, that if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. Secondly, it's to make God a liar. Because 1 John chapter 1, verse 10, the Bible says, "He who says he has no sin is calling God a liar, and the truth is not in him." So it's a dangerous thing to deny the reality of sin. And friend, to laugh at sin is to be a fool. And the last thing we ought to do is sit around watching television and laugh at sin. We ought not laugh at sin. Proverbs 14:9 says, "Fools make a mock of sin." And friend, to tone down its awfulness is absolutely tragic. It's tragic. Sin is an awful thing. Sin cost Jesus' life. Sin took him to the cross. Sin drove in the thorns and put the crown of thorns on and drove in the nails. That word sin, the word hamartia, It's a word that translates sin, just simply means to miss the mark. And the mark there is referring to the will of God. So to sin is to miss the will of God. And all those who miss the will of God, what are they called? They are called sinners. And so the basic elements of sin are really twofold: God's will and man's transgression of that will. You can take all sin and wrap it up into that. That's what sin is: God's will and man's transgression of that will. And you see, after a person violates the will of God, which, by the way, is at conception, when a person violates the will of God, is at conception, because David said in Psalm 51:5, what? In sin and iniquity did my mother conceive me. So at that point, you see, we are sinners. So from the moment that we become sinners, everything else that the sinner does is secondary. Now, that's important, because we call people sometimes, we call them liars or thieves or rapists or homosexuals or whatever else the activity may display, but God calls them sinners, just simply sinners. He looks out at a human race that has violated the will of God by transgressing that will, and he just refers to all of them as sinners. You see, sin is basically rebellion against the sovereign will of God. It's the result of placing our will above God's will. And we sometimes have a misunderstanding of this, that the root of all sin, it's not lying, it's not cheating, it's not stealing, it's not fornicating, but the root of all sin is unbelief in God's way of salvation. That's the very root from which every sin that we see, from which it springs. And if you take care of that root problem, the problem of unbelief in Jesus as the way of salvation, as described in the Word of God. You see, we're made in the image of God, but friend, we're born in the likeness of Adam. And that's our problem. Born in the likeness of Adam, we, as his posterity, we inherit that sin nature at conception. So we come out of the womb as sinners. Are you saying, Pastor, that if a baby dies, that baby goes to hell? No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying I think that baby is protected by the grace of God, but I'm saying that when a child gets old enough to understand the difference between right and wrong, good and evil, God's way, man's way, I'm telling you, at that point, that child reaches what we refer to as Baptists at the age of accountability. That's not in the Bible. You'll not find it, but that's just the way that we describe it. And then that child is responsible for his or her actions. And the result of this being born in the likeness of Adam, what are the results of that? Number one, total depravity. Total depravity. You know Romans chapter 3, verse number 23, for all have sinned and come short of what? The glory of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But what does that mean? What does that mean to be totally depraved? Well, in Romans chapter 3, verses 10 down through verse number 18, he paints a picture of the person apart from Christ that is totally depraved. As it is written, Romans 3:10, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. They are all turned aside. They have all become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. Their throat is an open tomb. With their tongues they have practiced deceit. The poison of asp is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. In the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. That's what it means to be totally depraved. It means that evil has contaminated every aspect of our personality. It means that we have no innate ability within us to love God. It means we have no ability to accomplish our own salvation. It means we have no ability to desire, understand, believe, or apply spiritual truth. And friend, that is why that when we are talking to sinners, the first message we ought to give a sinner is the gospel. Not telling a sinner, hey, you need to stop fornicating, or you need to stop stealing, or you need to stop cheating on your spouse or whatever it might be. Listen, they're just doing what their total depravity demands. And they're not going to do any different until we give them the gospel, because it's the message of Christ that delivers people from the power and the bondage of sin. So the first message that we give to a sinner is what? It's the message of the gospel. Jesus died for your sins. He was buried, raised again the third day. Friend, maybe I'm just kind of a dumb country boy, but I believe there is so much power in just the simple gospel. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. My father-in-law was just an old-timey gospel preacher, and I got saved under just hearing the gospel. It worked back then, and it will still work today. So now listen, because of this total depravity, the result is we receive a deserving penalty. And what is the deserving penalty for our total depravity? It's death. Over in the book of Romans chapter 6, verse 23, for the wages of sin is death. First of all, that's physical death. What is physical death? Physical death is the separation of the soul and the spirit from the body. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, for it's appointed once for men to die, and then after this, the judgment. Luke 23, verse 46, we read about physical death, the separation of the soul and the spirit from the body, and the life of the Lord Jesus. When Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Having said this, he breathed his last. He gave up the ghost. He died physically. There was a separation between his body and his spirit and his soul. Into thy hands I commit my spirit. Where was his spirit? In the protective hands of the Father. Where was his body? It was in the grave. So there's physical death. I'm not worried about that. But friend, I am worried about the next one. And that's spiritual death. What is spiritual death? It is separation of the soul and the spirit from God. Isaiah 59, 2 says, but your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. You see, if in the end we still have our sin that's not been dealt with and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ, guess what's going to happen? There's going to be spiritual death, a separation of our spirit and our soul from God. And we need to understand, when the Bible's talking about spiritual death, that's not annihilation. That's not just like everything's gone, you know. That part of us that thinks and that is aware and that is cognizant, that part of us is going to be just as much alive as it ever had been, but it's just not going to be in the presence of God if we experience this thing the Bible calls spiritual death, which Revelation 21:8 refers to as the second death. Second death. We're all going to die the first death, but friend, no one has to die the second death. And I tell you, it's tragic to even think about that. Second death. Over in the book of 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, the Bible says, let me just back up to verse 7, and to give you who are troubled, to give you rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, to take vengeance on them who know not God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. Wow, you see, that's the second death. That moment when our spirit and our soul are separated from God. But thank God we don't have to experience that, because the Lord Jesus paid that penalty for us, didn't he? That's why we, like Erica, ought to have joy in our lives. We're not in the baptistry, but man, we ought to be rejoicing because we have been saved from that. And so here is what we need to know. what we as Baptists believe about the doctrine of salvation. Number one is we believe we cannot save ourselves. We can't save ourselves. Psalm 60, verse number 11, the psalmist said, "Oh, grant us help against the foe, for vain is the help of man." Now, no doubt the psalmist was talking there about some kind of a common enemy, or maybe he was talking about some kind of a military foe, but the same truth is applicable when it comes to our salvation. Vain is the help of man. Jeremiah chapter 13, verse 23. Jeremiah 13, verse number 23. "Can the Ethiopian change the color of his skin, or the leopard change its spots? Then can you do good who are accustomed to doing evil?" The answer is no. You know, can an African American pluck out the pigments from their skin? Or can a leopard change its spots? No. And what the Bible is saying, neither can we possibly save ourselves. Friend, all efforts at self-salvation are futile. They don't work. It's kind of like an anemic trying to give himself a blood transfusion. You know, he takes blood out of one arm, puts it in the other arm, says, "Man, great, this is going to heal me. I've given myself a transfusion." Well, the problem is you gave yourself sick blood. All your blood's contaminated. And friend, listen, us trying to save ourselves, whether it's through baptism, church membership, reading our Bible, trying to keep the Ten Commandments, whatever it is, that is nothing more than sick blood. It'll never save us. We cannot possibly save ourselves. That's what we believe as Baptists. So we believe that only God can save us. You see, if salvation in its deepest sense is deliverance from sin and death, then it is beyond anything I could ever possibly do. What can I personally do with sin and death? And the answer is nothing. You see, I'm free to sin, but friend, I am not free to cancel out its consequences. I'm not. I can't do it. No matter how badly I want to go back and remove a word or an action or a deed or a thought, I simply cannot do that. Only God can cleanse. Only God can deliver. Only God can forgive. Friend, we need more than just behavioral modification. We need heart transformation. And only God can do that. You know, only God can forgive sin. That's one of the reasons I know Jesus is God. Because Jesus forgave sin. As a matter of fact, it alerted the Pharisees to the fact that they thought he was committing blasphemy. Because when Jesus forgave the men's sin, the paralytic that was let down before him, and Jesus said, "Your sins are forgiven," they said, "Blasphemy, because only God can forgive sins." And so that's why we possibly cannot take God out of the equation and try some other avenue in order to have our sins forgiven. Only God can save us. Psalm 3, verse 8, salvation belongs to the Lord. Psalm 25, 5, "Lead me in thy truth, for thou art the God of my salvation." Psalm 68, 20, "He that is our God is the God of salvation." Isaiah 43, 11, "I, even I, am the Lord, and beside me there is no other Savior." Isaiah 45, 22, "Look unto me, and be ye saved, all of the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is no one else." That was Spurgeon's great verse, wasn't it? You know the story of Spurgeon trying to go to church one day, and yet there was such a snowstorm until he could not make it. So he ducked into a little chapel building where a guy was preaching that day who was not a pastor, was a layman, because the pastor couldn't get to church that day because of the snowstorm. And the guy was illiterate, he was uneducated, and he shouted out over and over again, Isaiah 45, 22, "Look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else." And Spurgeon, as a boy, looked unto God and was gloriously saved, not led to Christ by a pastor, but by an ignorant layman who just shouted out the word of God about God being our Savior. We also believe that God's supreme act of salvation was in Jesus Christ. The Old Testament is absolutely filled with acts about God's deliverance, the Red Sea, the Jordan River, and on we could go. But the greatest, the supreme act of salvation was in Jesus Christ. That's what the Christmas angel said, "For you shall call his name Jesus." Why? "For he shall save his people from their sins." That's what Jesus said in Luke chapter 19, verse number 10, "I have come to seek and to save that which is lost." That's what John 3:17 says, "For Jesus came not into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." That's what the early church believed. They said in Acts chapter 4, verse number 12, "For there is no other way, because there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." Acts chapter 16, verses 30 and 31, when the Philippian jailer ran in trembling and said, "What must we do to be saved?" What did those early apostles say? "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." Friend, that message has not changed. That message is still the same today. We also believe that his salvation is a gift of grace. By grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. We believe that it can't be earned. It can't be merited. It can't be purchased. We believe that the wealthiest person in the world doesn't have enough money to buy it, and the poorest person in the world can receive it. That's what we believe about salvation. We believe that those who scrupulously give all of their effort, they've kept the moral laws, they've kept all of the religious rituals, we believe at the end of life there's no way they can trade all that virtue in for the gift of salvation, because it's free. It is a gift. It is for the best of the best and the worst of the worst. Friend, the gospel is addressed to those who have no resources to pay. And I'll stop right here. I got a bunch more, but time caught me. Let me just close with this. The last book of the Bible, the book of the Revelation, the last chapter in the Bible, this sums it up, what we believe as Baptists about the doctrine of salvation. The Spirit and the bride say, "Come." And let him who hears say, "Come." Let him who thirsts come. Whoever desires, let him take of the water of life freely. Freely. No charge. And if that doesn't make our joy bells ring, what possibly could? I want you to bow your head for just a moment, and after talking about salvation like this, I can't leave without giving an invitation. Maybe someone is here, you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You've been thinking about being saved. I want to give an invitation for you tonight to come and ask the Lord Jesus to come into your heart and life. I'm going to ask the instrumentalists just to play through just a verse or two of the hymn of invitation. You're not sure if you're saved, you want to be saved, you want to be forgiven, or maybe God's led you to become a part of our church family. An invitation for you to respond. You just need someone to pray for you and pray with you. But if God's dealing in your heart tonight, I want to invite you to respond to Him. And Father, thank you for the free gift of your amazing, glorious salvation. God, thank you that in grace you came in Christ to provide for us what we could not provide for ourselves. And oh God, if there is anyone here tonight who knows not the Lord Jesus, who wants to know him, I pray that even now, as I'm praying, they would get up and they would begin to come forward. As our ministers are standing down here at the front, they would come to them and say, "I want to be saved tonight. or if there's someone that you have directed to this place, they're searching for a church home, and you have said to their hearts, this is it. Gifts I've given to you can be employed here at First Baptist. Lord, I pray that they would come. So, Father, as we wait for just a few moments, may the Holy Spirit of God draw and attract people to Christ to make those spiritual decisions. In Jesus' name I pray.